Good afternoon. I'm Chong from Singapore Poly. I want to present to you the use of design thinking in CDIO project. Now, I know you are all familiar with CDIO, but design thinking may be new to you. So I'm going to share with you what is, these are the 4 points. Now, first thing, I will describe the typical CDIO project done at the second year in the Singapore Poly. Now, I also would talk about the difficulties they face during the conceive stage. How do students conceive good project ideas? Now, then I tell you roughly what design thinking is. I'm not an expert, I'm also new to design thinking, but we have been through a few rounds of design thinking in CDIO project. So I'm going to show you what are the some of the improvements we observe and some of the constraints of using design thinking. Actually, I have many slides, 32 slides, so I have to rush through them 20 seconds per slide. Okay, so this is a CDIO. Now, it's done in 30 hours over 15 weeks. Now, we don't have much time for operate. I think it's similar to many of the other institutions. No? You have CDI, but you don't have time to maintain the project until the end of the life cycle. That's the same for us. Now, I just want to point out this. Now, it's done by second-year polytechnic students, so don't expect very high standard in their project, no? The final project. We don't have a nuclear power. No? Okay. So a typical class of 20 students would be divided into teams of 3 or 4 persons. We don't want 2-person team, but sometimes we allow 5-person team because of the number in the class. Okay. This, although we call it CDIO project, is actually a microcontroller application module. So the only constraint they have is the project must use a microcontroller. They are free to dream of anything under the sun, but it must use a microcontroller. Okay. Now, these are our students, 17 to 19 years old. Not very mature yet. Okay. And you can see some of their project ideas later, whether they make sense to you. As engineers. Okay? Now, the students have free choice of interest, no? Area. Now, they are free to work on, for example, solar power project. They can work on aerospace. They can work to help the handicapped or make something for the elderly people. Handphone with a big button and so on. They are free to choose any area to work on. Now, we teach them some method to conceive good project ideas. For example, we teach them how to interview people, maybe interview in pair, one person asking questions, the other person note down what the person says. Now, we also teach them some brainstorming technique. For example, don't judge an idea too early. Let the person speak freely and so on. And we also teach them some method to differentiate their project idea from others. Now, after that, they are sent to the field to do their study. Now, 1 or 2 weeks later, they come back with some, not only the problem, they also come back with the solution. Okay. Now, they present their idea in the form of a concept sketch. For example, you can see this one here. It's actually we call it portable distance alert. If a person is sitting too close to the TV, the orange light would be blinking to say, no, you're too close to the TV. It's not good for your eyesight. So if you don't move away from the TV within a few seconds, the red light will be blinking. If you insist on sitting close to the TV, the power supply will be cut off. Well, that kind of project, you know, they think of all sorts of problems. They are free to dream of any idea. Now, after the concept sketch, they are back to their comfort zone. They draw block diagram, flow chart, Gantt chart, and so on to plan their project implementation. Now, these are some examples of the project implemented. For example, this lady here lead a team of students to do color sushi plate sorting and counting. So there are some color sensor inside. Now, another example. This one, the LCD there will post some max question. The kid must answer the question correctly before the car will continue moving. Now, one, you will find that they are not very nicely packaged because they are done by electronic students. They can't do mechanical fabrication quite well. Now, the other issue is, did the student actually interview the kids? Do the kids want this kind of toy? or would they prefer iPad? No, we can't compare. Now, one thing that is lacking is this. The student don't have much time. They only have 30 hours to finish the whole project. Now, second thing, we can't handhold the student. As lecturer, we can't handhold them because they have very varied area of interest. Some people like to help the handicapped. Some people want to improve their canteen experience and so on. So we can't organize something for them. Now, the students are also very young. They are very inexperienced. They can think of things that they think are useful, but actually they are craps. Now, so what is design thinking? Now, if you go and Google this term, you will find Tim Brown, Standards D School. Okay, this is what Tim Brown has to say. Design thinking can be described as a discipline that uses designers' sensibility and methods. Sensibility and methods to match people's needs with what is technologically feasible. So it's not the typical technology project. You have to know what the user wants. And then you use what you can do, okay, your technology to solve their problem, not something you can do, but it's what they want. Okay? Now, in Singapore Poly, we simplify the design thinking process into three key steps: empathy, ideation, and prototype. In empathy, we try to gain a good understanding of the user's needs. For example, all people, all folks, what do you think they need in their house? Is it a big red emergency button so that when they fall down, they can press the button? Not likely, right? When they fall down, they can't even get up how to press the button. No? So we do a lot of this user empathy. Later, I'll show you one example. Now, after empathy, they go through what we call ideation stage, where they generate plenty of ideas. One team could be generating 50 ideas within 1 hour. 50 ideas within 1 hour. So that they have many choices to choose from. Now, this is not a straightforward linear process. There's a lot of iteration. If you find that you can't generate enough ideas in the 1 hour, you better go back and understand your user again. There's something missing in the link. Okay? Now, after ideation, they create what we call quick and dirty prototype. They don't create a functional prototype. They may create their prototype using styrofoam. They may produce a video. They may do a skit just to show people, is this what you want? You talk to me about your needs. Is this what you want? Now, the idea of the quick and dirty prototype is, you want to fail, you fail early when the cost of failure is still low. You don't want to implement the whole project and then find that it's of no use to the user. Now, as you can see, this design thinking process of three steps actually map to the conceive and design part of the CDIO process. Okay. Now, as I mentioned, I'm going to show you one example of what we do with design thinking. Now, in September 2009, we have 80 students from three different schools together with 40 end users. Now, they are so-called senior citizens, meaning above 50. I'm close to that number now. Now, we form 20 multidisciplinary teams, and we spend 4 days just to understand the user. 4 days, compared to the typical CDIO project, 30 hours over 15 weeks. We spend 4 days with the user just to understand what they need. Now, the theme is Dream Home for the 50 plus. Now, as you can see, we have a theme, then we can organize some outing for them. If we give them free choice, you can work on anything you like, then we can't organize anything for them. Now, this is what we do. We have 4 days. Somewhere along the journey, they come up with some quick statement of what they want. For example, this guy say, my dream home is on top of a mountain. Now, I think that is difficult to achieve in Singapore because our tallest mountain is Bukit Timah Hill. And if you want a valley, you need 2 mountains. We only have one. Okay. Now, we spend half a day doing what we call ice breaking. We want to know the user so that they will talk. Now, we also give them, this is a bit cool, we ask them to bring their favorite magazines. And they have to cut some words and pictures from their favorite magazines. And then they create what we call a mood board. just to communicate to us what is their idea of a dream home. Now, then we also conducted some interview. We asked our 50 plus to be interviewers. We think that they can talk to other end users of the same age group easier compared to our 17-year-old student. Now, we talked to many people. We even went to the old folks' house, okay, to study the living environment. What do they have now? And what do they want change? Now, after all these interviews and observations, we have come back with plenty of observations, ideas, insights, and so on. And then we start to create some project ideas for them. Now, these are some of the ideas we created, the student created. Now, first one is a horizontal fridge. Now, it's difficult for the elderly to bend to pick up some item from the bottom tray. So we created something like that. Now, the next idea actually is the 42nd. Actually, you can see how many ideas the student generated during that 4 days. Now, the old people like to have garden in their house, but sometimes they want to go on holiday. Okay? We are trying to create something that is hassle-free for them. They don't have to water the plant every day. The electronics will take over. No, just put in some timer, some valve, you solve the problem. And if they want to save electricity, maybe put in a solar panel, somewhere. Now, if at the end of the 4 days, we are still not ready to start implementing the project, we spend another 4 hours per week over 8 weeks just to refine our ideas. Now, you can see that design thinking doesn't aim for fast convergence. We don't want to converge into one final project idea quickly. We want to take a step back and ask ourselves, have we really found what the user wants? Okay? And then we don't focus on solution. We focus on getting the right problem first. Now, what is the end result? Now, after the another 8 weeks, we started implementing, and the project will carry into the final year. Now, this is the hassle-free gardening. Now, we can see it's actually hydroponic. We use water with nutrients to grow the plant, no soil. Okay, there's a solar panel there to generate the electricity required for the microcontroller and so on. Now, this is another project, elderly-friendly PC with touch screen. Okay, it's easy for them to use. It's as easy as iPad, okay, but you don't have the chance to try it. Now, I put down this qualitative comparison because it's hard to do a quantitative comparison between before design thinking and after design thinking. Now, what we do observe is, in using design thinking, we can see that there's some evidence of user research. Compared to the last time we sent the student out, they come back with some problems, solution, but did they interview the user? We didn't know. But this time, we want them to work on user research and analysis. We want evidence of those things. You can see that we focus on identifying the problem, the what, instead of the solution or the how. Okay? And the project details will arrive at after a lot of discussion, a lot of iterations and so on. We don't zoom in and not say, this is the best project idea we can create for this group of end users. Now, so it doesn't, it's not a cure-all solution. There are some constraints. For example, you need to spend plenty of time to do user study. Because the students are still quite young, we need to do a lot of facilitation. We have to guide the student. Now, not only that, this thing is the key problem. You have to believe that design thinking, meaning spending time to understand the user, is actually worth your time. If you say, okay, just do a micro mouse for me, move through the maze in the fastest time, then it's very different from what we are doing. We are asking the student to go and study the end user, observe them, interview them, to find out what they need before they start working on the solution. Now, so this mindset change is quite a difficult thing. And if you know some design thinking tools, for example, in the empathy stage, in the ideation stage, in the prototype stage, what are some of the tools you can use? Now, Singapore Poly actually has come up with a design thinking tool set with different tools for the empathy, ideation, and prototype. And not only we have tools for the three steps, we actually classify them into beginner, intermediate, and advanced. So if you're a beginner, you're interested to try design thinking, maybe you can start with the beginner tools. For example, how to interview a person. It's not something totally new to you. You may have done something similar in the past, no, in the project.